remember growing older. When did they?
I have Sherman Daniels. This is exciting because I won't even be 86 years old for another 6 weeks. But anyway, the idea of it is to explain, have my children have a living history of our family, the people from whom they came, and what of our characteristics they have learned and have become part of them without knowing why.
Mom and Papa Sherman immigrated from Russian Lithuania sometime prior to 1894. They came from a town called Kovno Gubernia. The modern name of the town is now Kanaus. It's located in central Lithuania, which you can see on the map. The pictures are from Kovno. They were taken in the early part of this century. Some of them were taken by a man who returned from America in 1920. There was a ghetto containing over 10,000 Jews in Kovno, and these people were all killed during the Second World War by the Germans after putting up stiff resistance. There's a wealth of information on the internet about Kovno, should anybody be interested in pursuing that.
I'm from Des Moines, Iowa. Spent practically all my life there. My father and mother began their married life there. It was a letter courtship where he wrote her to Russia and they corresponded. And he said, "You come and I will marry you. If you don't want to marry me, you don't have to." She always said, I never believed whether he really wanted me to be married. But they did have a 55-year wedding anniversary, so it probably worked.
Mom and her three sisters and her brother Ben grew up in a house on 3rd Street in Des Moines. It was a town where the transportation was by streetcar, and there were gas lights before their house was converted to electricity. She had an allowance of 25 cents a week. Movies were a dime, and car fare was 5 cents. She went to Drake University, and she describes herself as an eager beaver. She wanted to get into everything. Wanted to get her foot in the door and try this and try that. So she was on the women's baseball team and on the women's hockey team. And her children would now chuckle when they think of their mother trying to tag somebody out as they slid into first base.
Drake University played a big part in my life, and it was, I think they stimulated me to think. We were trying to raise money for a girls' swimming pool, and they started to say, let's have a play, and I wrote a musical comedy based on a play, but with new music and new words. And after it was over, they were singing and whistling it on the campus, around the campus. As I looked back, they were horrid. That would never, never match with the rock and roll stuff. They were all philosophy things, like what was tinsel, tinsel, tinsel. All the world is made of tinsel, you know. Then there's teeter-totter, ups and downs. It would not match today's life, but they made quite a big fuss over it.
Grandma Daniels and her husband Julius came from Germany. Grandma Daniels was from the town of Heidenheim, in southern Germany, in the state of Württemberg. Julius was from Prussia. They immigrated to Chicago probably in the early 1880s or even in the 1870s, possibly. They were married, and you'll see their Jewish wedding certificate. It's interesting to see that the S is deleted from the last name of Daniels. on the marriage certificate. They had three children. Leo's daughter Arlene is with us today. Max had no children, and Ross had the three boys, Jay, Dick, and Clark. Ross, as a young boy, was sort of a rascal. He got in trouble at school. He recited a poem that he'd selected called The Face on the Barroom Floor, which was thought to be too risque for young children. He was expelled from school. He was later sent to a Catholic high school where it was felt that the priests who were the teachers could handle him. The war broke out in 1914, initially America was not interested in taking part in the war. But with the sinking of the Lusitania and unrestricted submarine warfare, Americans' spirit changed to wanting to help out England and France. Our family apparently took up this patriotism very strongly, and they wanted to show themselves as Americans. One might speculate that they were sensitive about the fact that they were immigrants, and particularly immigrants from Germany. Both Max and Ross entered the army and went to France eventually. Ross seemed to like soldiering. He talked about the camaraderie of and the good friends that he made in the army. One thing he didn't like very much was getting up early in the morning.
Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning. Oh, how I'd love to remain in bed. For the hardest blow of all is to hear the bugler call. You gotta get up, you gotta get up, you gotta get up this morning.
He went to France in early 1918, crossed the Atlantic on the battleship Iowa, and debarked at Brest. When he got off the ship, he was met by a train of wounded coming back from the front. He tells the story of how one of the soldiers with an amputated arm waved the arm at him and told him how much they would enjoy being in France. Fortunately, he never fired his rifle in anger and was never shot at. But the next part of the story was he by happenstance, he ran into his brother Max in France, and they were so glad to see each other that they sat down and wrote a letter to their mother. At the end of the war, on Armistice Day, he was in Paris. Well, the war ended, and he went back to Chicago and was a salesman of women's and children's clothing, and was traveling throughout the country when he called on Papa Sherman's store, where he was introduced to Ethel, and they were subsequently married on October 3rd, 1926. They moved to Chicago, and apparently were pretty prosperous there for a while. They lived in a nice apartment in a nice section of town, and he surprised his wife with a birthday gift on the first year they were married by buying her a Steinway piano, and she was very thrilled about this. The stock market crashed in 1929, and Ross lost his job, and they moved back to Des Moines. They lived with Papa and Mama Sherman for the first year, probably because they couldn't afford to pay rent. The Depression hit them very hard. The family never went hungry, but there were many who did. Unemployment rose to 25%. There were strikes and lockouts. People were angry. Farmers were losing their land because they couldn't sell their produce and their livestock to pay the mortgage. The veterans marched on Washington demanding a soldier's bonus. People were afraid of a general uprising. ¶¶
Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once in khaki suits, gee, we looked swell, full of that Yankee doodle dum. Half a million boots went slogging through hell, and I was the kid with a drum. Say, don't you remember they called me Al? It was Al all the time. Say, don't you remember I'm your pal? Buddy, can you spare a dime?
Things apparently improved. They moved to a rented house, and then finally to the house on Waterbury Circle, where they remained for the next 20 years. They purchased the house for $7,000 in 1936 and sold it in 1956 for $13,000. It was a three-bedroom house with one and a half baths, and had a nice little woods for the children to play in. Jay was bar mitzvahed in 1940, and we can see a picture of him. It was an occasion for Uncle Max to visit from Chicago, and this was one of the times we got to see him, which we really enjoyed seeing him and his wife. Pearl Harbor was attacked in December of 1941, and this was a very emotional moment for the whole family. We all felt as though we were being beaten up by a big bully, and we followed the war very closely and followed it, what was initially the defeats at Bataan and Corregidor and the German attack on Moscow. Then finally the victories at Midway and North Africa and Italy. There was a very big moment that came at the time of the invasion of Europe, where we were waiting for this for many months, and then one morning we woke up and it was announced that the invasion had occurred. And this is the newspaper headline of the Des Moines Register at the time of the invasion. That night, the three Jewish congregations in Des Moines met at Tiferet Israel Synagogue, where we prayed for the safety of the invading armies. It seemed as though at that time that we could see the beginning of the end. And although the war lasted yet another year and there were setbacks, nevertheless, the war ended, and there was a great celebration at the time of the, particularly the victory over the Germans, and then later on the victory over the Japanese. So this time we were all growing up, we were teenagers, and Jay was in college, and they continued the draft for quite a while after the war, and Jay was drafted and spent 6 months in the Army. Jay graduated from the University of Minnesota, and it was shortly after this that the Korean War began, and Dick enlisted in the Army. He was sent to Korea. He spent a short period on the Korean Peninsula, and then was a guard on a prisoner island at Kojedo. And his letters from Korea really talk about the boredom of life in the Army, and he was very happy to get out. It was a very difficult time for the family. They worried a lot about Dick, and also the business, which had been started a few years earlier, was doing very badly, and was already close to bankruptcy, so there was a lot of strain in the family at that time. Well, things finally improved, and Jay and Marlene were married, followed by Dick and Alice, and Karen and Ross later were born, and Dick and Alice's children, Mark, Larry, and Susan. I went to medical school and later to Cincinnati for postgraduate training. Ross was and Ethel were finally able to leave the Iowa winters and spend their winters in Florida, felling over their children and grandchildren and making new friends, playing gin rummy, and enjoying the cuisine of Miami Beach, going to the races and just having a good time. There was no question they were an adventurous couple, and there was romance in their lives. Ethel wrote a song before they were married called A Man in a Million, and she often said that Ross was her man in a million. They were sensitive and emotional people, but yet resilient and able to ride on the roller coaster of life. Dick would often laugh and say that Mom could embellish shit. And it was true. She was a Pollyanna, and she often spoke of the accomplishments of her children and her grandchildren, and would never speak of her of their shortcomings. There is one comment that she made several years ago that I think would be fitting to finish this history with. And it concerns her her working at the office and what she thought about doing housework.
So it was natural that when we got into this business, I would do publicity for the Ross Root Theater, and I would always have to do those things because I could do anything rather than to do housework. So if I kept writing, I could get someone to do it for me.
The grandchildren have now grown up. Karen and Steve are married. Larry and Lisa are married, and later Mark and Adrian are married. Oh, now yeah. We have great-grandchildren.
Everything grows and grows. Babies do, animals too. Everything grows. Everything grows and grows. Sisters do, brothers too. Everything grows. A blade of grass, fingers and toes, hair on my head, a red, red rose. Everything grows, anyone knows, that's how it goes. Yes, everything grows and grows. Babies do, animals too. Everything grows. Everything grows and grows. Sisters do, brothers do. Everything on the farm, fish in the sea, birds in the air, leaves on the tree. Everything grows, anyone knows, that's how it goes. Yes, everything grows and grows. Under the sun, that's how it goes. Under the rain, everything grows. Anyone knows, that's how it goes. Yes, everything grows and grows. Babies do, animals too. Everything grows. Everything.